movie I made of me doing stuff with my hands, like picking things up, squeezing them without crushing them, typing on a keyboard, playing piano, writing with a pen, things I could not do without the sense of touch. We manipulate objects. Neural signals from our hands convey information about the shape, the size, the texture of the objects, if the objects are moving across our skin. These signals tell us what direction they're moving in, how fast. So these signals are what allow us to actually do things with our hands without constantly looking at them to make sure they're doing the right thing. So, you know, my undergraduate example is you're at a party, you're having a conversation, you don't have to stare at your hand to make sure the beer is still in the hand, right? So, but it's actually more serious than that. It turns out that without these tactile signals, these neural signals from the hand, we would struggle to do activities of daily living, like opening a doorknob or brushing our teeth, forget about tying your shoes or buttoning up your shirt. But you don't have to take my word for it. This is a video. The next video was made by my colleague Roland Johansson at Umeå University in Sweden. And this is a video of a lady doing a simple task of everyday living, which is to just imagine a problem. Moments later, the same lady is going to do the same task. The only difference, she's sober, she's neurologically normal, she can see what she's doing. The only difference is that her fingertips have been numb. The index and the thumb fingertip have been numb. And suddenly this seemingly trivial task becomes super challenging. And she even starts to cheat, uses her third finger before finally she gets it to work. So this gives you a sense of, you know, how basically without the sense of touch, our hands would be these strangely shaped, essentially useless appendages at the end of our arms, right? So imagine, so now that you've seen sort of or got to have an idea of what it's like to try to use, to pick up and manipulate objects without a sense of touch. Now imagine you're trying to do that with a robotic arm. Now in this video, a quadriplegic patient, you can see her head there at the bottom right corner, has been implanted with an array of electrodes in the motor parts of her brain. So she's paralyzed and insensate from the neck down. She has some electrodes implanted in the motor parts of her brain. And my colleagues at the University of Pittsburgh have developed algorithms that from the measured activity in these motor parts of the brain, can in real time decode the intended movements of this patient. As a result, she can actually control this robotic arm by thought. The idea is, you know, when you move your arm this way, there's a certain pattern of activation in those parts of your brain. You move your arm another way, there's another pattern of activation. And these guys have figured out how to read out the intended movements from these patterns of activation. Isn't that amazing? This person can actually move this robot with her mind. You know, that's amazing. But now if you look a little bit more, once you kind of get over the dazzle, right, and you look a little bit more carefully, you'll notice that she's struggling a little bit to pick up these objects and to move them, particularly the small objects. And that's not at all surprising because she doesn't have a sense of touch. You would struggle to do this test too, if you, with your own arms, if you didn't have a sense of touch. Ultimately, this is what we want to achieve, right? Forget about trying to play guitar with prosthetic arms. This is from the movie RoboCop, which I'm not necessarily endorsing here. Okay, so how do we go about this? So when we touch objects, the skin is deformed, and receptors in the skin are activated. And the pattern of activation of those receptors depends on what we're touching and how we're touching it. Signals from these receptors travel up the arm in the nerve and ultimately result in a pattern of activation in the brain. And this pattern of activation also depends on what you're doing and or what you're touching and how you're touching it. Now, in a prosthetic hand, there are sensors that replace these receptors in the hand. And what we're working on is to develop algorithms to convert the output of the sensors on this prosthetic hand into patterns of electrical stimulation of the brain to mimic this brain activation that would be produced in the native organism or in the intact organism. So how do we go about this? So To develop this algorithm, we carried out a series of behavioral experiments in monkeys. In brief, what we did is we taught these monkeys to discriminate touches on their hands. And once we had trained them on these tasks, we started replacing surreptitiously some of these touches on the hand with electrical stimuli applied to the brain. And we assessed whether the animal responded to these electrical stimuli applied to the brain in the same way that they did to the touches that they replaced. When you pick up an object, you need to know which part of your hands is touching the object, right? So minimally, you need the thumb and one of your fingers to touch the object so you can pick it up, right? And so in your brains, right, we have the part of the brain that receives input from the hand, it's called the somatosensory cortex, comprises a whole complete body map. So what that means is when something touches your face, one part of the brain becomes activated. When something touches your hand, another part of your brain becomes activated. And what we showed in our experiments is that we stimulate a part of the brain, we can elicit a sensation that is localized to whatever that part of the brain responds to. So for instance, if we stimulate neurons that respond to the index finger, the animal felt as though its index finger had been touched. So this phenomenon can be used to convey information about contact location, what part of the hand is touching an object. But I'll come back to that later. The other thing you need to know when you pick up an object is how much pressure you're exerting on it. You need to exert enough pressure so as to not drop it, but not so much pressure so as to crush it, right? And touch naturally conveys very precise information about the pressure we exert on things. So how do you convey this information about pressure through electrical stimulation of the brain? So we hypothesized that the way to convey this information about pressure was by increasing or decreasing the amount of current that was delivered to the brain. So the idea was, for more pressure, you deliver higher currents. And this idea came from the facts, these measured facts, that when you exert more pressure on an object, more and more neurons become activated. Similarly, when you crank up the juice, more and more neurons become activated. So we thought, because these two things seem to do the same thing, maybe they'll have the same sensory consequences. So we tested this, and we came up with a function that related the pressure that was exerted on an object to the amount of current that should be delivered to the brain to produce an appropriate sensation. So in other words, if you have a low amount of pressure, you get this faint sensation, a strong amount of pressure, a strong sensation, so we wanted to be able to mimic that by electrically stimulating the brain, right? So this actually allows us to do that mapping between pressure and current. And I don't have time to tell you how we got there, but I'll tell you how we proved that this algorithm works. What we did here is we trained the animals to discriminate in a pressure discrimination task, where now we're touching them twice, And we're asking the animal which of these two touches was stronger, the first or the second. So after a while, the animals can learn to do this task. Once the animals had learned to do this task, what we did is we had them do the exact same task. But instead of touching their hand, we started touching a prosthetic hand with sensors on it. In exactly the same way that we touched the animal's actual hand. And then in real time, used this function to convert the output of this pressure sensor into electrical stimulation applied to the brain. And of course, I wouldn't be here if it hadn't worked. It turns out that the animals were just as good at doing this task, whether we poked their hand or poked their prosthetic hand. So they had just as much information about exerted pressure from their native hand or from this prosthetic hand, which showed that our algorithm worked. So how does this all come together, right? I mean, ultimately, we're interested in trying to improve the life of quadriplegic patients. Quadriplegia is a devastating condition. And the trick is, what we want to be able to do is to devise algorithms to convert the sensor, the output of the sensors on the hand into patterns of electrical stimulation of the brain that elicits meaningful and hopefully intuitive percepts, tactile sensations, right? So how do we go about this? Well, first we need to hook up the sensors to the electrodes, right? Now remember, I told you in some of our experiments we showed that if you stimulate through a given electrode, the patient is going to feel a sensation at a specific location on his or her body, in this case, on his or her hand, right? So unlike our monkeys, the patient can talk. So we can stimulate through an electrode and ask the patient, where do you feel that? Anytime the index finger touches something, electrical stimulation will be delivered through electrode 35, and the patient will feel something touch his or her index finger, right? So then the next question is, how do we stimulate through electrode 35? Well, I showed you a function that takes the output of the sensor's pressure and converts it into a current such that the sensation is of appropriate magnitude for whatever the pressure was. So again, it's going to lead to a faint percept for low pressure, a strong percept for high pressure, right? So now the patient will not only be able to feel where the thing is, you know, or where the prosthetic hand is touching something, but how much pressure is being exerted on that thing. So for reasons that hopefully I convinced you early on in this talk, we anticipate that this is going to have pretty dramatic effect on the patient's ability to actually use this hand, just the way without touch you would have difficulties using your own hands. Another thing will come out of that that's really interesting and cool is that this robotic hand will be embodied. It'll start to feel like part of the patient's body. The reason being is that anytime a patient touches something with that hand, he or she will feel a sensation like the kinds of sensations that you feel when you touch something with your hands. So that'll lead to the embodiment of this arm. So that's cool, you know, contact location, contact force, is some really basic information to be able to grasp objects, but of course touch is way richer than that. I told you earlier, you have information about the shape, the texture, the motion of objects, the size. So in my lab, we're trying to expand the repertoire of touch sensations that can be achieved through electrical stimulation of the brain to try to reproduce this rich tactile experience that we have access to. So, including the sense of touch, incorporating the sense of touch in these robotic arms will have a major impact on sort of the quality of life of these patients. But if you think about it now, you know, sort of on the longer term, this idea of interfacing brains directly with machines can have sort of much broader, sort of far-reaching implications that could change the world that we live in, just kind of like the internet and computers have changed the world that we live in over the last few decades. But on the shorter term, a quadriplegic patient will be equipped with this robotic arm that will not only restore the motor side, like I showed you earlier, but the sensory side as well. And that individual will be able to reach for an object and then feel the object with this robotic arm. And that line between science and science fiction, it'll have been pushed back just a little bit.